there is an overlap between urban geography and architecture. That's what we're hoping to explore today in the talk. I've called the talk Inhabiting the City. One of the themes that Pierre asked me to address was the idea of housing. How does housing take place in the context of the development or the evolution or the reality of the city? And I had to remind myself before the class, because I know this is an urban geography class, and I thought, well, what is urban geography? What does it mean? Where does it sit in relation to what I do? Realize that there are lots of things that are called urban, and they're often intersect with different fields or different disciplines. And today, what I'm talking about is not really about defining things, it's about a set or a range of ideas that relate to the city. And I imagine as students of geography, you have specific interests, you're interested in study. In this class, the study of cities, the study of the features of landscapes, built form, the human inhabitation, the patterns, all the dimensions that conspire to form a city. But there's also, aside from urban geography, is urban sociology. It's the study of the behavior of people, how people relate in cities. There's urban politics, the very specific politics that operate on the urban or a city scale. And then we also have urban planning. Urban planning, of course, is a discipline that is engaged in trying to project into the future what a city will be like or what it could be, taking into consideration economic factors, social factors, commercial factors, physical factors, parameters and constraints. Urban planners try and plan ahead, and they'll try and align the planning for cities with all the other ingredients and factors that inform the evolution of the city. And then finally, there's urban design, and that's the aspect of the study of the city that I think my discipline as an architect is most closely related. And that's what we're going to focus on today. Just for clarification, does anybody here know what architects do? Anybody suggest an understanding of what an architect does? Anybody know? Have we got any ideas? Yeah? Buildings. Yeah, architects design buildings. That's one of the things architects do. Anybody have any other thoughts about what architects do? Yeah?
Is that infrastructure?
Yes, infrastructure, yeah. So buildings and infrastructure. Any other suggestions or thoughts about what architects do? Yeah? Yeah, that's a very good, organizing the layout and positioning of things within space. Yeah, so basically architects deal with the design of space, and that can be buildings, it can be rooms, it can be the fitting out of a room like this, or it can be like a building like this, or it could also be the planning of a campus, or the planning of a city, and that's when architecture moves into what is known as urban design of urban spaces. There are also architects who get involved in landscape architecture, the design of landscapes. But architecture is really the umbrella term for anything that is related to the design of spaces. And it's a peculiar discipline in that part of it is analytic, scientific. You know, when a client comes to an architect and says, well, this is what we want to do, we want to design a new university, or we want a new house, or we want a new kennel for our dog, or we want a new office building. First thing you have to do as an architect is analyze the requirements, analyze and understand climatic constraints, the constraints of the site, all of these different aspects that will inform how the space will develop. And then you move from that analysis into synthesizing that information and projecting through the process of design how it's going to look, how it will be made, how it will be configured, how it will operate over time. That's the process of design. Sometimes people tend to think of architecture as something that happens after the engineers have done their work, but architecture is a wide field and a diverse field, but essentially it involves analyzing the world, analyzing the requirements of clients, and synthesizing those, that understanding, and trying to creatively create space that satisfies those requirements and satisfies the needs of the people that use it. And part of that is an aesthetic side of it. Part of it is, obviously, you want the environment to be attractive. You want it to be pleasant. So color, form, and all of the things that we enjoy and appreciate when we look at art or we listen to music also have a place in the practice of architecture. It's a kind of generalized, we're not here for a lecture on architecture, but that's just a generalized understanding of what architecture, how you might understand architecture. And in terms of urban geography, urban design and an understanding of urban design, I imagine, is part of understanding what urban geography is. So I've tried to today bring to you some thoughts and ideas from a design perspective, the impact on some rather specific dimensions and aspects of urban geography. And I'm going to talk to you in a sort of sequence of things. The first part of what I'm going to talk about is the concept of the city. What do we mean when we say a city? Obviously, it's a huge, it can mean many, many things to many, many different people. We're going to look at the concept or the idea of a city. What is a city? We're going to look at the morphology of the city. Does anybody know what morphology means?
Changes.
The changes, yeah. Morphology, morphic, changing. Cities change over time. As human beings, we grow and we change over time. And cities change over time. And that process within the discipline is often referred to as the morphology of cities. The form and the nature of the city, how it changes, how it transforms itself over time. Morphology of the city. And then we're going to talk about the relationship of the city and architecture, the city to architecture. It's kind of impossible to imagine a city without architecture, but clearly they're inextricably related. It's impossible to understand the city without people. So people, architecture, the city, they're linked in some way. And again, we're not going to talk in any definitive way today, but we're going to discuss that, and by the end of today, I want you to have some sort of thoughts and ideas in your own mind of how you understand and how you embrace the relationship between architecture and the city. And then we're going to talk about inhabiting the city, living, and how do we live in the city, and the idea of housing. Most cities, anywhere you go in the world, a huge proportion of the space that is occupied in the city is occupied by housing, where people live. Yes, there are businesses, and there are roads, and there are parks, and there are schools, and there are offices, and there are museums. Those are all different typologies, types of spaces that exist within cities. But a really important typology is that of housing, where people live. And that can mean somebody living in a huge mansion. The Prime Minister of our country lives in a huge, huge, huge structure in St. Anne's. It was built 10 years ago. It's probably the biggest residential dwelling in the country. And then we have people who live on the streets, people who don't have a physical home, but they're housed, they're accommodated in the city. So cities are also where people live. It's an important understanding. Housing doesn't just mean a house. It means the act of living, the act of dwelling, of living, of shelter. And it's a very important part of the administration and management of urban space. How do we deal with housing? A few years ago, some of you may or may not know this, but the world underwent a very significant shift in that it was estimated, I think it was in 2012, that suddenly more than half of the population of the world lived in cities. So we moved from a world where people were living different towns, villages, settlements living in the landscape, to where more than half of them lived in cities. And people move to cities because they're attracted to work, to opportunity, to economic, all sorts of reasons. And it's a global phenomenon. People move to cities because They want to better themselves, they want to advance themselves, and they feel, maybe they're wrong, but they feel that maybe the city is the place where they're going to achieve that, because there's a lot of activity there, there's a lot of money there, there are lots of things to do there, there are lots of opportunities there. But of course, when they move to the cities, they have to live somewhere. And that then becomes the problem or the challenge for whoever governs the society. And there are mandates, global mandates by the UN, that really demand and require that nations acknowledge that citizens have a right to shelter. Most countries in the world, that's acknowledged within the constitution, within the legislature, within the laws of the country, within the moral and ethical parameters or understanding of the country, that people need shelter, they need somewhere to live. So it's something that's embedded and ingrained in most societies, and it's something that underpins and underlines our concept of the city. And it's going to be the focus today of what I talk about in terms of cities, in terms of design. And then finally, we have the idea of urban design. So how does the discipline that I'm involved in as an architect, that also entails and involves designing cities, urban design, the design of cities, how does that intersect with these issues? How does that represent itself? How does it manifest? How does it operate? I don't sit in my little office thinking up wonderful ideas for housing and just go out and draw them up and build them. I need clients. I need the client to come to me. If it's a private house, when you've all graduated from here and you've got jobs, settle down in whatever structure you want to settle in, you might want to build a house. And you're going to need help. You'll have to come to an architect. So you'll come to me, or you'll come to one of my colleagues and ask me to help you design it, because you don't have that skill or knowledge. Similarly, when the government wants to build housing, they go to architects. But how does that process take place? And are we satisfied with our process? Are we happy with what we see? When we look around, we identify housing in this country. Very often one can identify different types of housing. So you can identify informal housing, where people have just put up whatever they can, or whatever means they have. People who are at the lower end of the economic and social scale, they need a house. They might squat on some land, and they might acquire materials that allow them to build that, and they build it themselves. And you go from that all the way up to high-end residences, villas, apartments. And then in the middle of that, the government is trying to build housing, it's trying to kind of knock out units of housing. Is everybody here familiar with any government projects, government housing projects that they could name? You know any? Maloney Gardens is one. Does anybody here know Maloney Gardens? Yeah. Can you name any others? When you drive to the airport, we see Orofoon on the right, that's another government housing project. So there's an activity of design that goes on in providing housing by the government. And that process is informed by different strategies, different approaches to design, different approaches to the procurement of buildings. So we're going to talk about these areas. We're going to talk about the concept of the city. We're going to talk about the morphology of the city, how the city grows over time, the form and the nature of the city, the relationship between the city and architecture. Then we're going to talk about housing, what housing means, and how that manifests itself in our cities. And then we're going to talk about how urban design, how design impacts and affects urban development and the evolution of the city. I'm going to start off by talking about the concept of the city. I guess I mean the city as an idea, how we imagine the city. Does anybody recognize that? Does anybody know where that is? Can guess? Which continent do you think that is? Have a guess. Is it in the Caribbean? Is it in China? Where do you think it might be? Have a guess. Australia. Yeah, that's the city of Chicago. And you can see that that city has a very distinct relationship to the earth. You know, it's in a flat plain. It borders a big body of water, and there's a concentration of what looks like commercial development. It has a very distinct character and identity. It's also clear that it has a relationship to the water. That's a lake. Chicago sits on a lake. And its origin in that location is based on a whole set of factors. Historical factors, economic factors. When the United States, when America was being colonized, Chicago became a very important city for people who were trading and who were moving and having to transport goods, transport and trade furs, and later on it became a very important place for transporting the grain and the produce that was grown and cultivated in the Midwest. So it has a history. And the form and the nature, the morphology of Chicago is informed by that history. So it gives us an idea. There's an idea about Chicago that we have in our mind when we visit it or when we see it. It's very distinct. It's distinct from London. It's distinct from Shanghai. It's got its own character. Cities are clearly not all the same. They're different, and how they evolve depends on where they are, depends on culture, depends on economics. Does anybody know where that city is?
Cologne.
No, it's not Cologne. China? No, it's not China. Any other guesses? There's a very famous building in that picture. If you look at the sort of bottom left corner, there's a fairly big structure going on there. Does anybody know what that is? What? It's not England, no. That city is Barcelona. Barcelona has a very famous plan there. The plan of Barcelona was undertaken by a man called Cerda. C-E-R-D-A. And it's a very beautiful plan made up of these urban blocks that have very kind of dense and rich character, and the relationship of the blocks to each other has been thought out very carefully, so the sidewalks are nice and big. And if any of you have ever been to Barcelona, it's a wonderful city just to walk around, because there's this lovely life on the street level. There's a density and a richness of the activity. It's not a city where there's all the business in one place and then people live in another place. It's all mixed up. It's a kind of richness to it. And it's part of a design. Somebody thought about that when they planned the city when it was growing, and they designed it to be like that. It's a very significant urban design. And that building in the bottom left corner is the Sagrada Familia. And it's a building that was designed by an architect called Antonio Gaudi. And it has taken around 100 years to build that building, and it's still not finished. It's still under construction. So again, it's another aspect of urban development, that there's this idea of time. Cities take time to develop. They don't just suddenly appear. Sometimes cities suddenly appear. Sometimes cities grow over time. That's how they change. And this is a plan of Barcelona. And you can see, again, in the bottom left quadrant, there's a sort of slightly dense and irregularly patterned part of the city. That was the original part of the city. And the grid that surrounds it was developed in the 8th and the 19th century by Cerda to accommodate the expansion of the city, to allow the city to grow and develop in a structured and ordered way, but in a way that gave it quality. And most importantly, that housed people. It didn't just say, we're going to build office buildings here, and we're going to build factories here, people can live wherever they want. It integrated them. Those blocks contained businesses, industries, butchers, libraries, schools, and housing. People living in apartments mostly. But it was part of a concept, it was part of an idea, and a way of accommodating the huge movement of people to the city because of the economic activity that was taking place in that city at the time. So again, it's a concept. We looked at Chicago, this is Barcelona, they're very different characters. It's not just about how they look, it's about their history, it's about their nature, it's about all the factors, historical factors, political factors, economic factors, that led to their evolution, led to their establishment. Okay, next one. Anybody recognize that city? Have a guess? Speak up, can't hear you. Anybody recognize it?
Could be Venice.
Venice? Why do you think it's Venice?
Because mostly because you can see this like waterways.
Canals. Yeah, that's a good observation, but it's actually not Venice, but that's a good observation. It's a city that's built around canals. Anybody think of another city that's built around canals?
Amsterdam.
Very good. That's Amsterdam. Again, completely different form of Barcelona, completely different structure. And in this case, it was built in a location where dealing with the water was a big issue. Amsterdam and bits of Holland lie below sea level. So the system of managing the water, it's like Georgetown in Guyana, that's another city that's built around canals. So Amsterdam, a very important trading city from the Enlightenment on, and its structure and form was built around the infrastructure. Somebody mentioned architecture, design, and urban design being around infrastructure. This is a good example of whoever was planning or designing Amsterdam was having to very carefully consider how the city would evolve and how it would grow in relation to how they were going to manage the water. And they used the water also not just for, they used the canals not just as a means of preventing the city from flowing, but as a means of communication and movement through the city. As a means of, so not just using the road, but using the canals to move through. So again, it's another concept or idea for the city. It wasn't that somebody sat down one morning and came up with that idea. It's an idea that evolved from the needs and the requirements of the people that live. Okay, there's another one for you. Anybody, any idea where that is? Is that a city in the Caribbean, I think? Okay. Is it a city in Europe? Is it like a city in Europe? Is it like a city in North America? Where do you think that could be? I didn't hear what you said. South America, very good. Yeah, getting warmer. Any other offers? Where? Not Brazil, no. That is Mexico City. Mexico City is one of the biggest cities in the world, and Mexico City evolved a little bit like Port of Spain, although we're not one of the biggest cities in the world. And that it started off as a colonial city, a colonial outpost. Structured like that, very ordered and regimented grid that the colonial power imposed on the landscape. And then, because of the huge population and because of the economic activity that was going on there, it just then, its boundaries exploded. And people just came and lived wherever they possibly could in a fairly disorganized way, let's say, in an informal way. It wasn't planned. This part of Mexico City is not the planned part. It's where people came to live. Where people came to make their own houses and their own structures. Okay, anybody know where that is?
New York.
Yeah. Very clearly identified in New York, that central park in the middle there. And, you know, instantly recognizable image of a city, incredibly dense city, you know, a city that evolved and came about, very important time. You know, the center of civilization at one point in the 20th century really moved from Paris to New York for a period of time. I'm not sure where it is now, but it became the epicenter, a very dense place. A lot of money there, a lot of activity there, a lot of people living. Again, one of the biggest cities in the world. And the city that came about as a result of some very kind of careful and considered planning, the grid of New York, I think is a famous example of city planning, of ordering space, of defining space, describing space in a way that would accommodate a range of different functions along the grid that was formulated, and also provided in the middle the amenity of Central Park. But again, very strong idea. And Manhattan, which is really, when we say New York, we're really saying Manhattan. New York is actually five boroughs around what we're seeing there. Including Brooklyn, Queens, the Bronx, Staten Island, they're different boroughs. The whole population of New York is probably nearing 20 million now. And of those, I think maybe 7 or 8 million live in Manhattan, which is an island. It's actually pretty much exactly the same size as the island of Anguilla. It has 14,000 people. So an idea of scale and demand for space, it's a very dense, and also has a very strong identity. And accommodates lots and lots of people, most of whom live in towers because of the premium and the value of space. People need to go up because they can't spread out the side. So that's to really talk about the idea of the city, the concept of the city. So cities have characters. You know, they have qualities, they have characteristics. So in a way, they're part of our imagination. It's true that they're represented by facts, by buildings and things you can measure. You could count the number of people that live in a city. You could measure the heights of the buildings. You could quantify the amount of electricity that is used every day. There's all these analytical and quantifiable aspects of cities, but then there are also the qualitative sides of it. You know, the character of the city, the nature of the city. There are important things to understand in terms of how we conceptualize the city, how we understand, how we appreciate the city. And again, housing and the fact that people live in the city, that people inhabit the city, is a very, very important and fundamental aspect to how we appreciate and conceptualize cities. So now I'm going to talk about a city that I imagine that you're all familiar with. Is anybody here not from Trinidad? Where are you from? St. Vincent. Barbados. St. Vincent. But you're familiar with Port of Spain? Yeah? Everybody's been to Port of Spain, knows Port of Spain. You know, Port of Spain is our capital. This is a photograph of Port of Spain, downtown Port of Spain in the 70s. Old aerial photograph, black and white aerial photograph. And it's kind of interesting because on the left-hand side, you can see the original colonial plan of the city, the grid of the city. It's very clear, it's very legible in terms of the character of our city. And then you can also see, next to the water, it's kind of messy. It's kind of, you know, there's the port, there are all these little disaggregated buildings, all these sort of different types of activity that are going on there. And you can see very clearly the highway coming in and turning into Wrightson Road, kind of separating the city from the sea, dividing the city from the sea. And then to the right, you can see Lavatil, what was originally the informal settlements of Lavatil, where people were rushing to the city, coming to inhabit the city because there was activity there. People wanted to be near that economic center and that kind of activity. So the form of the city reflects the importance of its location geographically as a port, its historic identity and history in terms of the colonial grid, and then this idea of this rural, urban drift movement that happened in the 19th century when people came to the city. They didn't want to work on the land anymore, they didn't have to work on the land, they had to come to the city to benefit from what was happening in the city. And there was no government, there was no housing development corporation at that time. There was nobody handing out houses or building houses, so people made their own informal settlements. It's a process that continues to this day in many forms in the city of Port of Spain. And the idea of the city, the concept of the city, started off looking a little bit like that. This is a painting done by Michel-Jean Casaubon in the 19th century. And it's a painting of what is now Independence Square. At that time it was called Marine Square. And it's taken from pretty much the bottom of Frederick Street, looking east towards the cathedral. And you can get an idea of the scale and the nature of that space at that time. If you know Independence Square now, it doesn't look anything like that. But you can still recognize what might be called the urban form. We can still recognize the importance of where the cathedral is. You can see that the buildings on either side have had a commercial use, and maybe above those they have had a residential use. It's a recognizable form. Some of those trees are possibly still there. There have been different redevelopments of Port of Spain, the Brian Lara Promenade project in the 90s, so it's a space that's been redeveloped over time. But this is what it once looked like. And this image is another image by Michel-Jean Casaubon, and it's taken from Lavatil, looking west, where the railway station is. This is what it used to look like. And if you look very carefully, you can see the lighthouse. It was actually on Wrightson Road, that's where the highway meets Wrightson Road. You can see that was right out in the water at one point. Whereas now, it's been embraced by the land through this process of reclamation. So there was this thrust, there was this energy to try and develop the city. And all of this forms part of what we were talking about earlier, the morphology, the changing form and nature of the city. the city as it expanded. And it's by design. People designed it. People were thinking about what form it would take. People were thinking about how it would develop. What were the types of spaces that were required? What we're seeing there is commercial development. That was commercial land. But at the same time, the city was being more densely inhabited. And all of this was happening in the context of history, in the context of the movement of people, in the context of the process of colonization, exploitation of agricultural produce, of minerals, and the movement and the trade that people undertake all over the world all the time. And what happened in Port of Spain at a particular moment in time was subject to these forces, and those forces determined and defined its evolution like any other city, gave it its character. This is a sketch by John Muir Lewis where he describes, of course, the heritage of Trinidad and Tobago, how it evolved, and the different forces and influences that came to play on it. And that impacted on the way that the architecture was expressed. At one time, before there was any serious trade going on here, really the only materials that were available was timber. People could go and chop down trees, they could make a coarse kind of plaster, and they would make their buildings out of wood and a kind of crude plaster. But then with bigger ships coming in, those ships then brought in prefabricated components like steel and like iron. The ships often came from Europe loaded with bricks as ballast. Keep the ships weighted properly as they came out. They would then offload the bricks, load up the sugar, the coffee, and the cocoa, and the other stuff, and head back to Europe. And those bricks were then used to build buildings. So if you look around, the library, for example, in Port of Spain, the old library, not the new library, the old library on the north side next to the town hall, that's made of London stock brick. Those bricks were made in London, and they would have been brought as ballast on a ship that came out to trade. So there's a whole nature and form of the history of the development of the city that's embedded in the architecture, revealed in the architecture. I'm going to run through now some images that talk about the evolution of the city. This is a map from the 1930s. And this is a little sort of blow up of what Port of Spain looked like a long time ago. On the left hand side, that little blue streak running down is the Maraval River. Comes out now somewhere near the stadium. And on the right-hand side, you'll see two rivers meet each other, two little tributaries at the top. The one on the left is the St. Anne's River, and the one on the right is the Cascade River, and they meet to form and continue the St. Anne's River. And that river ran all the way down to the coast. And the first settlement here, when the Spanish came, there were Carib settlers here, and they lived in a little cluster at the mouth of that river. There was a settlement in Port of Spain. And that place where that settlement is, you can see the little dots representing the settlement, it's probably around where Nelson Duncan Street are. It's that kind of area. But it was very marshy. It was a kind of swampland. It was a wetland. So when the Spanish came, they moved the river. They rerouted the river to drain that area of land. I'll just go back to so you can see that. They moved it. And they moved it just north of where Piccadilly Street is. They rerouted it. Before that, it used to run across Port of Spain. The river used to run across Nelson and Duncan Street, where Woodford Square is, and come out there. And they moved it so that they could drain the land and permit this denser settlement. And the Spanish actually had laws about how cities were set up, called the Laws of the Indies. If you Google the Laws of the Indies, there it's like a charter describing when you were designing a city, the rules that you needed to follow. And the Laws of the Indies were based on establishing a grid. They also enforced the primacy of the idea of the church in the city, and the public square, the builder, the mayoral building. So there were these rules or regulations, and that's what happened in Port of Spain. The form and the structure, the early form and structure was imposed by the Spanish following the Laws of the Indies. And they were laws that were established that provided a framework. And it was a framework that was based on an understanding of how European cities were developing at that time. Because European cities were very dense, they were very unhygienic at that time. Lots of people were rushing in. There were no developed systems of sanitation or sewage. So European cities in 17th, 18th, 19th century were pretty smelly, nasty places. But when they came to the New World, the Spanish said, okay, let's put this grid out and then we can organize the disposal of the sewage, we can make the place healthier. It's like a fresh start. So cities like Port of Spain were predicated. And in fact, most cities throughout the Caribbean, St. Vincent, for example, Kingston, are cities that were built and evolved from similar grid patterns. And those grid patterns accommodated settlers because they knew people were going to be living there. They weren't just a military outpost, people were going to live there, so people needed to have healthy lives. So the planning of the city allowed that quality of life to prevail. So these are just some early drawings of that first plan that the Spanish set up that were done by Olga Mavrogordato many years ago. And then the city began to grow. Grew north, encompassed the savannah. And in fact, the form that the city evolved, what happened, some of you may know, in the early part of the 19th century, there was the cedula by which, a law by which the Spanish colonizers gave the French settlers the right to colonize or to cultivate estates. And the country was divided up into a whole series of estates. And in fact, the shape of the savannah is the shape of the estate of one of the families, the Laperouse, not the Laperouse family, the Pesce family, who gave their land to the city because the city was now growing. It came around. So the whole form of that was actually formerly the shape of a plantation. And in fact, St. Clair was also the name of an estate. There were different estates that had different names, and they were slowly, as the city expanded, appropriated by the expansion of the city. So we looked earlier at different cities having different forms and different characters because of historical influences. Well, those are some of the influences that influenced what happened to our city, our capital city. So the city grew, continued to grow, taking us up to something like how it is today. And this is a little overlay that I did. The darker areas are the older areas, and the lighter blues are the phased expansion of the city over time. And you'll see a whole series of lines on the coast, and that's the changing profile of the sea, but constantly changing through reclamation. If you look at the left, that big bit sticking out, that's where Movie Town is, where Invaders Bay is. There's this constant desire to try and reclaim more land because it's valuable. People need space. If you go north, it's hills. You can't really build on hills. It's much too expensive to build on hills. You put houses up, you can't put large buildings on hills. It's too expensive. So there's this tendency to try and reclaim land, to maximize the use of the space that is available by reclaiming land from the sea. The other thing that's evident in that image is the fact that you've got this very dense settlement with a hill behind it, and then it means that there's a kind of highway or a main route that separates the sea from the city. It's another characteristic of the city. And then we have our Queen's Park Savannah, that's like our central park. So we have our own character. There's a form and a nature and a morphology of the city that has evolved over time to give us the city in the present day. So now I want to talk a little bit about architecture of the city, the relationship. We've looked at the idea of the city. We've looked at the idea that cities are kind of organic, that they grow, that they change. They're subject to all sorts of different forces, economic forces, the movement of people. They're subject to the need for certain types of infrastructure, like canals in the case of Venice or Amsterdam. So there's a whole morphology, there's a whole kind of organic form and nature as to how cities evolve and how they emerge. And we spoke earlier about how it's hard to imagine a city without architecture. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the architecture of the city and how that would evolve. Does anybody recognize that? You know where that is? Port of Spain. Whereabouts in Port of Spain? Frederick Street, yes. That is Frederick Street. What year do you think that is taken? I don't know what year it was taken, I'm curious. But what, there are clues in it as to what year it could be taken. There are cars, yeah. Light posts, if you had electricity. Lots of people on bicycles. And if you look at the guys on the bicycles, they are riding between some lines. What do you think those lines are? Tram lines, yes. What are we seeing in the building? What sort of buildings are those? What do you think happens in those buildings? Speak up.
Lower levels would be commercial, yeah. And the higher
ones
would be
hotel. Well, actually, these are pretty much 100% commercial buildings. And they are, you know, you still see the evidence of some of these buildings. Some of those structures are still there. They're wrought iron structures. They were actually fabricated in Glasgow and in France and imported as components and then erected to make kind of a mixture of a warehouse and a store. So they're like warehouses and stores. And they have clear story windows at the top to let light and air come in. And they probably have the admin offices on those balcony levels, and then the street below is where people walk and access the commerce and the activity. And we can see also there's a privacy in that to the pedestrian. Pedestrians look quite comfortable walking around or cycling around. I don't think I would enjoy cycling down Frederick Street today. You might not make it to the end. But at that time, it looks like people were a lot more comfortable doing it. And there were cars, but it doesn't seem like there are as many cars as there are today. So again, it's an interesting example or an image of what the character of the city was like a while ago. And understanding that and how the architecture reflected the history and the nature of the culture of people was a very important preoccupation for a man from Guadeloupe, who sadly died a few years ago, called Jacques Berthelot. And Jacques Berthelot was an architect from Guadeloupe, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with the politics of Guadeloupe and Martinique, but Guadeloupe and Martinique are part of France. They are département. They are. If you're born in Martinique, you have a European passport. So they're really still like colonies. That's how they operate. That's how they're structured. People like Jacques Berthelot wanted independence. He wanted to be part of the independence movement that characterized the English-speaking Caribbean. He wanted to be separated from France. And in his own discipline as an architect, he tried to investigate what he thought was true, real, genuine Caribbean architecture. He thought that was very important. He didn't want buildings to look like colonial buildings or to look like they came from Europe or from the United States or anywhere else. He wanted buildings to be characterized, to reflect this culture, to be reflective of the integrity of a particular culture. And he wrote this book. And he did many beautiful drawings in this book called Casantier, Jamou Kaite. It's in Creole, it means the Caribbean house, the place where I live. You know, it's about the house. So in his search for an architectural identity, he thought of the house as being a very important element of that understanding, a very central. He didn't talk about the city. He didn't talk about the office building. He talked about the house. But where people lived as being the place, the type of space that was most reflective the character and the culture. And he did a very beautiful book where he traveled around the Caribbean and he studied how people made houses. He went everywhere. He went to St. Vincent, he went to Nevis, he went to Dominica, he went to Jamaica, Trinidad, Haiti, he went everywhere. And he would study the simple dwellings that he found. He found many similarities between them in different lands, but also many differences. And he created a kind of typology of form. The different types reflecting the different cultures of the different islands. I thought this was a very important thing to do because it would reflect the culture of the people. That if one understood how people built in a natural or intuitive way using the materials around them, then you would have a very strong and clear and close idea about how you might build things in the future. That you didn't just have to then copy things from Europe or copy things from America. You could build them in an authentic way that was rooted in culture and identity. And it comes back to this idea of the character of the city. This is about the character or the quality of the architecture. These are studies that he did. Again, some more studies. And then he did this really nice typology where he identified a whole load of things. And I'm showing you. So he would identify what he called archetypes, architectural typologies of each island. So this is what he identified as being the archetypical dwelling in Antigua. It's not that all dwellings look like that. But in most vernacular dwellings, most simple houses in Antigua, you would be able to recognize and identify some of these features. So it was a tradition, it was part of the culture of the place. It was important to record it. Grenada, And this is the Grenadian type. Anybody that's from Grenada will probably recognize that type as being something that they're familiar with. It's not radically different from the Antiguan type, but there are differences. And those differences evolve from an understanding of what type of timber was available. Also, the climatic conditions. Some islands, as you know, in the Caribbean are subject to hurricanes and some are not. Some have heavier rainfall than others. So all of these subtle differences were reflected in the vernacular houses that Bertel identified throughout the Caribbean. And he tried to ensure that in making typologies, that he reflected what those nuances were, so that he would have a deeper understanding about the cultural production, about the culture of the place. It wasn't so that he could go and build them like that. It was to understand what was there, to understand the nature of what was there, and to see what clues or ideas that might give for how things could be done in the future. Barbados, this is the chattel house, you know, the kind of archetypal house in Barbados. And then Trinidad. In Trinidad, you can see we've got a slightly bigger eave. And then Haiti. So these were, there are many of these. I've just showed you a little cross-section of them. But they're all in his book, Caribbean Style. I think there's a copy in the library here if you want to have a look at it, together with a lot of photographs where you've got all this information from. But what this does really is shows and demonstrates that we have the morphology of the city and the character of the city changing over time. We know that there's a relationship between architecture and the city, but architecture also changes and evolves over time. It changes in response to technology, it changes in response to economics, it changes in response to the skills and the desires and the aspiration and the imagination of people, responsive to many, many things, many human characteristics, human desires and human needs. And again, as Bertel shows, central to that is the idea of the house or the shelter or the dwelling, where we live. So the city is the bigger place where we live and the house is the individual place where we live. So these are related concepts and related ideas that it's important to understand moving forward. So what I would like to do now is I'm going to give you two examples. Might think of them as case studies. And I'm going to show you two different approaches to housing that have been adopted in different parts of the Caribbean, at quite sort of different ends of the scale. The first is in Guadeloupe, and the second one is a project that was undertaken in Haiti. And these were projects that have been undertaken by Caribbean architects in the Caribbean for Caribbean people, and by people who were very influenced by Jacques Bertel. They're modern architects, they live now, they live in today like you and I, but they think it's important that somehow the architecture they produce doesn't just copy what's happening in America or what's happening in Canada or what's happening in Japan, but that somehow reflects the culture of this place. Yes, there are techniques, there are methods, there are ideas that we do want to embrace that form part of what's happening in the rest of the world, but we also want the architecture and we want the place where we live to reflect our own culture and to reflect our own identity. And that's open to interpretation. That's open to the subjectivity of the designer in synthesizing his analysis of whatever the problem is. So the first project I'm going to show you is done by two very good architects. Their practice is called Pilefas. Pilefas means heads or tails. It's Emile Romney and Marc Jallet. And they're very, very interested in housing. All the work that, not all, the majority of the work that they have done has been in housing. They're both trained in France, as all the architects in Guadeloupe and Martinique were. And when they came back to work in Guadeloupe, they entered competitions because the government has competitions. All public projects in Guadeloupe and Martinique are won by competition, not by the cost, not by who does it cheapest, by competition for the best project. So if there is a school to be built in Moruga, there will be a competition, and all the architects and other plans can enter that competition. And the people who judge it are people from Moruga. There'll be an architect, there'll be an engineer, there'll be somebody, and they assess and they determine which they think is the best design for that particular project. And it means that there's a very high quality of design in those places because it's competitive. And all public projects are obtained that way. There's no bidding who does it cheapest or who paid who off. It's all about quality of design. And they entered very early on these competitions, and they won them. And they were very concerned because they realized that the regulations for housing in Guadeloupe were regulations that had been developed in France for French housing, for French people. Now, of course, in the French government eyes, they were French people. But their culture was very different. The way they lived, the way that they communicate, the way they move, the climate, people's behavior, people's cultural practices were all very different from where they were in France. So they spent a lot of time trying to kind of bend the rules to make the rules fit how people in Guadeloupe. And I'll give you an example of that, was that one of the earliest housing projects they did, they recognized that in the housing typologies that existed in Guadeloupe that are quite similar to some of the lower income areas in Trinidad, that there was a very strong sense of community. The architecture might not be particularly sophisticated in some of these areas, but there was a strong sense of community. There was also the idea of the extended family and the family structure, the way that those operated in the inner cities in Guadeloupe and Carinage and places like that, where you might have a cluster of people living in a little courtyard or behind a larger house, like our barrack yards or tenement yards in Jamaica, where there might be a mum, a sister, a brother, a granny, an auntie, a couple of kids, some single people. You know, there was a cluster of people, a group of people that wasn't mum, dad, and two kids in a car. It was an unusual, unorthodox setting when compared to the French system. And they realized that's how people lived. So they structured some of the housing they did around little open courtyards, because they'd identified these open courtyards as being places of safety in some of the communities that they had analyzed. So they're very interested in the morphology of the city and the morphology and the typology of housing. And they try to invest their work with it. I can talk about them all day, but I'm just going to show one project that they did. This is a project, it's a significant part of Pointe Pitre that was, after the Second World War, it was developed as social housing, 3 or 4 story big super blocks of social housing. And 10 years ago, they found out that they were not seismically safe. But when they had been designed, the architects and engineers had not considered seismic considerations. And it meant that if there was a serious earthquake, all of those buildings were likely to be seriously damaged and there could be loss of life. So Mark and Emile got the job to redevelop this part of Pointe Pitre. It's called l'assainissement. L'assainissement was the name of the original development of these buildings that are now unsafe. It means the sanitization. It was an effort in the middle of the last century to get people out of the sort of the ghettos and the yards and put them in more modern accommodation, become housing. And it's important to remember in this context that France is kind of a socialistic country. They have very strong social programs. People are taxed very heavily in France, but there's a lot more effective social systems. The healthcare system and the system for housing is very, very strong. So it's recognized in France that the state needs to provide housing. So they have competitions to make sure that the quality of that housing is good, it's funded properly, the quality of housing is much higher. So in this development, Mark and Emil were asked to look at a whole section of the city and to redevelop it, providing green spaces, ensuring people could move around it effectively, and also to provide quite dense housing. Big demand for housing. So this is a schematic drawing. It just shows really the volumetric structure of the urban blocks that they put. And they use the dimensions of the existing blocks in Pointe Pitre, the existing urban typology, to formulate these new housing units. So these blocks were created, and you can see they haven't just made them all the same height. They've created courtyards in the middle. They've got trees and walkways. They've pushed the parking away. There are a lot of moves, architectural design moves in that, that work to make the place much more habitable, much more pleasant place to live. And then this is a rendition of one of the developments. So you can see, if you compare it, for example, to some of the social housing or low-cost housing that goes on here, this is a far richer solution. This does not look like the housing Oropoon with the airport. It's been considered far more carefully. It's the same purpose. It's housing people that are not in a position to buy their own house. They need the state to house them, to help them, house them. But their planning has integrated their existence into the middle of the city. It's not pushed them out to the edge. Found some cheap piece of land somewhere and just put up some blocks and tell people to go and live there. This is considered, it's integrated into the city. The communities that lived in the original buildings are intact and are still inhabiting. There are opportunities there for commerce, for trade. There's consideration for the comfort of the people in terms of the shade that is offered by the trees. And if you look at the architecture, they've had to use industrialized techniques, very sort of modern systems of building, but they've tried to introduce timber, they've tried to introduce color, they've tried to introduce elements that animate the space, that create an aesthetically pleasing resolution for the need for housing. They've also limited the height. Those are like five-story structures. The heights are variegated so it doesn't look monotonous. So thought has gone in to how housing could be provided in the city. Not just as a function of how many people per apartment and how many apartments you need to provide. That drawing is more about that, that's more the sort of logistical drawing. But how it's then manifested, how it then evolves, has to be very carefully considered to make sure that the quality of people's lives is preserved, and also that the culture of the place where people live reflects their existence and reflects their identity. I think it's a really good example of successful planning, and it's currently under construction. It's one of many examples of the work that they do where, in subtle, quiet ways, they're trying to kind of like push the boundary a bit. There's a limit. They've got to get so many people into a certain block, and there are some basic facts about that. But they've tried to do it in a way that is reflective of the culture. Has anybody seen any low-cost housing in Trinidad like that? Why do you think our housing doesn't look like that or doesn't evolve like that? Does anybody have any thoughts on that? Anybody familiar with any social housing or low-cost housing in Trinidad? We spoke earlier about Maloney. Are there any other examples? Anybody think of any? I think the key thing here, really, I guess the point I'm trying to make is that it's part of a process. It's part of a process and a concept. We talked earlier about the concept of cities, the concept of, as a society, we need to have a concept. To have an idea about this. We need to have an imagination of what it could be, what form it could take, what housing could be. And I think in Guadeloupe, they may not have it perfect, but I think they're going about it the right way. I think if I was a low-income person, if I had limited means, but I had the opportunity of living somewhere like that, I think I would be pretty happy about it. I think I would feel gratified. I think it would make my life and my existence easier. It would probably make functional things I have to do, like going to the shops or moving around the city or ensuring that my children are cared for. I think it would make those things much easier. And it would be something that I would be happy to identify with. I would be happy to live there. I would be happy to point out to people that I lived in that place because it has an identity, it has a culture. As a character like me that's reflected in the form of it. So this idea of the measurement or the quantification of cities, the analysis of cities, but also the synthesizing of the form of cities and how cities evolve, very, very important. And design plays a very, very important part of that. And I think this is a good example of some good architects facing the challenge of providing urban housing and managing to integrate it very effectively into an urban situation in the Caribbean. It's not America or France or Germany. This is a couple of hundred miles away from here. The next project I'm going to talk about is a completely different type of project. It's a completely different type of response, but I think it demonstrates a similar sensibility. He and his students wanted to do something to assist the people of Haiti. They wanted to kind of try and think of some way that they could help people in Haiti. And so they developed this prototypical housing concept that responded to the immediate needs of the many, many displaced people in Haiti who were no longer able to access any form of shelter or housing as a consequence of the earthquake. And they took as their point of departure, the idea of the laku. Laku is the equivalent to what we call in Trinidad the barrack yard, what's in Jamaica is called the tenement yard. Laku is the Creole word. It comes from lacour, the courtyard, the open space, laku. And it's how people in Haiti will identify where they live. So if you're living in a low-income informal settlement, you know, I might say I'm going to go by laku priya. I'm going to go to priya's place. It's not just her place, the group of people living there, but that's how we'll identify the laku place where she lives. And with the students, Andres analyzed Port-au-Prince. They looked at the morphology of Port-au-Prince, the capital city of Haiti, which was impacted by the earthquake. They looked at where people lived, where it was geographically. They looked at the topography of it. They understood the habits of the people. They tried to understand and they studied the different laku that they found there, how they were formulated, how they operated socially. They looked at all of these things that were nothing to do with drawing something with a pen and paper. It's about understanding and comprehending the nature and the form of the place, the morphology of the city, the urban form. And they also looked at Jacques Berthelot. You look on that drawing on the left, Jacques Berthelot's drawing of the Haitian archetype we looked at earlier. They looked to that to see what clues they could find in it. They didn't want to reproduce that. That's a model of architecture that comes from the 19th century, so they don't want to reproduce that. But they thought it would give them clues or ideas in terms of the joinery skills that people probably still have, the nature of space that people could occupy. And then you can see in the middle the temporary housing structure that they came up with. And this is temporary housing. This is housing that was designed for people to inhabit who had nowhere to live, who were living on the street, so it had to be put up very quickly. So they used standard size sheets of plywood. Plywood comes in standard sizes. It comes in 4 foot by 8 feet sheets. So they used this as a kind of module, so you didn't have to do much cutting, and so you didn't waste much of it. And they used simple hardwood frames, and then they pinned these boards onto the frames, and they formed the roof with corrugated galvanized iron sheeting, and they formed it in a way that reflected the angle from Jacques Berthelot, so there was a familiarity with the type, and they also formulated it in a way that it would attract air, that it would allow air at the higher level, because these houses were going to be located in fairly dense areas, it would allow air to flow into the house and to ventilate it. These are temporary houses, so the idea that they could be, once people now found a permanent place to live, these could be dismantled and moved somewhere else. And with the individual houses, they were arranged to form little laku. So they were formed in clusters. So the communities that had been displaced could move into these lakus in the same social structure that they had lived in before. So it wasn't that you were just given a number and then turned up to look for your housing and just sent over to number 565. They analyzed the communities and the social groups and they tried to place people, although it was in a different location, they tried to put people within little clusters or groups that they would be familiar with. So if I was used to living to my aunt, near my aunt or my friend or my mother or my grandmother, and we had a social dependence, that remained intact as far as it was possible to do within the structure. So these laku were created using these forms. And then this is just a kind of idealization in a way of the fact that there could be a whole number of lakus that were all then interlinked and then could share other facilities and amenities. So again, it's not like the Guadeloupe project, which is a big urban permanent. So this is a solution to housing in response to an emergency, you know, where suddenly a huge number of people don't have anywhere to live, and suddenly shelter is required. So how do you do it? How do you do it with just some sheets of plywood and some hardwood? How do you do that? Well, this is a concept for it that I think is really very nice, because it responds to social need, it responds to history, it responds to the idea of the social requirements and the human requirements of people, and places them in a setting that they're comfortable in and that they can identify with. It also has a quality to it, it's a recognizable quality. then the final image of that project just shows some different renderings, some different sort of animated renderings that show the formation and the formulation of the space, show the scale and the arrangement, show the simple constructional technique for these. One of the things that happened in Haiti with temporary housing models, that is because there were a number of temporary housing models that were introduced, you would have people that would live on the hillside in the informal settlements who came down into the city because of the earthquake. And when they were relocated into the temporary settlements, they didn't want to leave them. And they didn't want to leave them because the amenities that many of them had in those settlements were superior to where they had come from. So many people were living in shacks or living in informal settlements where they didn't have running water, they didn't have an operating toilet or latrine, they didn't have electricity, they didn't have, in many cases, proper shelter from rain and the elements. But when they moved into the temporary housing, they had it. So there was a big problem when people were moved into the temporary. They didn't want to move because they suddenly had something that they had not had for a long time. It was one of the fundamental problems of the relocation. The whole story of the housing in Haiti is a tragic story. I've been there a few times as part of some groups trying to alleviate that problem. It's a massive problem. Haiti has a population of about 10 million people. And I would say probably 7 or 8 million of those people live in pretty much what we would call substandard conditions. And trying to find a solution for it is very, very, very difficult, very challenging without the economic resources. But I think this was an admirable strategy. I think it was a responsive strategy. I think it's a response that gave people a kind of dignity in terms of where and how they lived. And it recognized the importance of housing, the form and the nature of housing, not just providing a box for somebody to put a mattress down, but an understanding that where you live has a social function, has an engaging function that relates to different aspects of society. Okay, so now we've looked at two examples of housing in the Caribbean, and now we're going to look at strategies. Different strategies that are responsive in different ways, you know, moving forward. If those are two examples of how people might have done things or done things in the past, what are other strategies for dealing with housing or dealing with urban living? How do we contest with, you know, we talked about Haiti, with the sheer number of people living in Haiti, you'd have to have a huge amount of money to suddenly be able to provide everybody with adequate housing. So how does one address that? How do we look at cities? And how do we improve the inhabitation of the environment of cities? What are the strategies that we could adopt? The first example I'm going to show you is Kunle Adeyemi and his project in Makoko in Lagos in Nigeria. I think it's a very special project. Kunle is a Nigerian architect, and he studied in Nigeria. He went to postgraduate studies in Amsterdam, and he undertook this project with some funding that he got as a means of trying to address some of these projects. He didn't go and chase big commercial projects. He wanted to address problems that he identified in Lagos, in Nigeria. I've been to Nigeria many times. My wife is Nigerian, and that is what Lagos looks like. Not all of Lagos, but that is Ikeja. It's a junction in the north of Lagos. Lagos is one of the biggest cities in the world. It's completely overpopulated. There are about 18 or 19 million people living in Lagos, and more people arriving every day. And it's crazy, really the only way to describe it. And how the amount of food that everybody needs to eat every day is moved around the city. How people get enough water to drink is almost impossible to comprehend, because clearly, when you go there, the infrastructure that you see doesn't provide it, and very often doesn't work. But yet it works. It miraculously works, it functions. And it is culturally very, very rich. It's a very powerful place to go. If any of you have ever been to New York, or been to Kingston, or been to Havana, there's a character to those places, and Lagos has that character. People from Lagos, Lagosians, are proud to be Lagosians. They're from a major city, a major port with a great history. So even though day-to-day life is challenging, and often onerous, and limiting. People are still happy and proud and find a kind of dignity in living there. And in addressing how he might look at it, or how, I mean, he might work with it, Kunle Ademi looked at Makoko. Makoko is part of the Lagos Lagoon, and it's a wetland, and it's a point at which all the logs that came from the forests in the north of Nigeria, the central Nigeria, would come, be floated down the river, and they would come out in this area called Makoko. They would emerge, these floating logs, and you can see some of them there, they would emerge there. And as a consequence, there were different trades and businesses that evolved around that. People who would be engaged in the sawmills, engaged with chopping and sorting the logs, would move to the boundary of Makoko. And eventually, that's the plan of Makoko, they started living there. They would build rafts out of the logs and build structures on the rafts and live there. That white band you see on the right is a big mainland causeway that takes you from Ikeja to Lagos Island. It's about 15 miles long. And when you drive along that from the airport and you look down, you see this floating city. In the distance, you can see downtown Lagos, Lagos Island, that's where the center of Lagos is. But this is Makoko, and it's huge. I don't know how many people there live there. I would imagine maybe 100,000, 150,000. It's huge. And they're all living in substandard conditions. There's no proper sanitation. There's no proper or effective means of movement other than informal movement on rafts through. So it inhibits the quality of life of the people there. It makes life there very, very difficult. On the one hand, it's probably attractive if you're a Lagosian because you're quite near the center. There's activity, commercial activity going on. There's a settlement of people there, an established community, but it presents its own very peculiar and particular challenges. And Kunle came up with what I think is a really very beautiful idea, in that he designed a prototypical structure in the form of a school. It was very difficult for the people in Makoko to send their children to school, because they first had to get them in a boat, then they had to get them to the road, and they had to get them from the road to the school, and it was just a difficult negotiation for them to do. So he brought the school to them. He emulated the form that they had adopted traditionally as part of their Makoko morphology, and he built a floating school. And that school could move around, and it could be planted in the middle of Makoko, and it was a form and an idea that was recognizable to everybody there. It was familiar. It probably made for them eminent sense for the inhabitants of Makoko that that's what a school should be like, because that's where they live. They live in houses that are formed like that. So whether one likes it or not aesthetically, it's really not the issue. It's this idea of responding to the needs. And this is not a house, but it's about inhabiting a landscape, and in this case, a landscape of water and timber, and building on that and drawing from that to create a form, to create a place that has a useful function and that serves a very useful purpose. And it's been so successful that it's projected that a whole range of projects be continued like this, housing different activities that then help the community. So maybe one would be a little medical center. Maybe another one could be a place where you could go and register for social amenities. All sorts of different amenities could be provided within Makoko using these floating ideas based on the floating school. So I think it's a really good strategy. It's not something that would immediately come to mind. Most of the time, somebody looking at a situation like that will want to get rid of it. Tell people not to live there, move out, move somewhere else, go to a proper school, do this. But the scale of the problem in the city is so huge, that's not really a ready option. So the idea of intervening, a little bit like what's sometimes called urban acupuncture, finding a little tender, sensitive spot, putting something there that solves a lot of the problem. It doesn't solve everything. It doesn't resolve the majority of the problems and the challenges that people there face, but it suddenly makes one issue much easier. It means that going to school is a very easy proposition for the child. Something like that can make an enormous difference in terms of the quality of people's lives and how societies evolve and develop. So I think it's a really beautiful urban strategy. It's a school, but it's also a strategy that's been conceived of on an urban scale. OK. Again, another interesting character with another interesting urban strategy is a guy called Enrique Penalosa. He was the mayor of Bogota many years ago, and he was confronted with, when he became mayor the first time, with a plan by the city for a Japanese construction company for millions and millions of dollars to build a new highway system in Bogota. And he said no. He said the traffic situation in Bogota is terrible. Adding highways is not going to make it better, it's going to make it worse. It will encourage more people to get more cars and it's going to exacerbate the situation. I want to focus, and this is Enrique Penalosa, he wanted to focus on encouraging people to use bicycles. That was his urban strategy. It wasn't about building monuments or building highways. It was like, the problem here is not about cars, per se. It's about people moving around the city. Most of the people in the city can't afford a car. So let us come up with a solution that addresses the needs for most of the people. I'll play you a little clip. That's Enrique Penalosa there.
Okay, here we are in part of the Porvenir Promenade. This is a 24-kilometer pedestrian and bicycle-only street which networks. Very low-income neighborhoods to the richest areas of the city. I think it's a revolution in the way urban life works. This kind of high-quality infrastructure for bicycles increases the social status of cyclists. Before we had bicycle ways, low-income people were ashamed of using bicycles. Now, a high-quality, protected bicycle way shows that a citizen on a $30 bicycle is equally important to one on a $30,000 car. And here is something interesting. You can see how the pedestrian and bicycle has pavement and the cars are in the mud. So it's a priority for the pedestrian and for the bicycles. And then later sometime we will pay for the cars. But first, the pedestrians. So this completely shows respect for human dignity, for everybody, not just for those who have cars, who normally think they are the important ones in developing country cities. Again, this is democracy at work. Buenas tardes, ¿cómo les va?
So that is Enrique Penalosa, and I think that's such a lovely idea. Yeah. And I think you know, the idea of, you know, I lived in London for a while. I had a bicycle in London, and it was fine to have a bicycle. As a student, cycled to architecture school. Everybody had a bicycle. It was cheap. It was much cheaper than taking public transport, which could be quite expensive to get around. You know, kept fit. But yet, in societies like ours, riding around on a bicycle, it's almost a laughable proposition, unless you're doing it as a sort of sport. You know, if you told your girlfriend or your boyfriend, I'll pick you up at 7 o'clock to go to the fair and turn up on your bicycle, it would seem laughable. But if you think about it, it's a good idea. What's preventing us from doing it is the roads. The roads are unsafe. The roads don't accommodate or facilitate that. It's stigmatized to have a bicycle. It's funny, you know, it's you know, better to have a car, a BMW or a fancy car, you know, but in fact, bicycles would make much more sense, and bicycles are accessible to everybody, and bicycles are fun. Everybody likes riding a bicycle, you know. There are lots of different ways in which projects like Penalosa's could be introduced in cities. In Norway, they're now developing links between major cities for people to cycle between. They want to actively encourage people to use bicycles to take longer journeys, not just smaller journeys. His idea, I think, is a really, really very fine idea, and something that, you know, it's useful to think about. Maybe it's an idea that wouldn't work here, or maybe it would, but it's important when we're strategizing about how we inhabit the city, how we live in the city, how are we going to move around? Do we want to risk our lives every day on the horrible roads, or walk in the sidewalks and get splashed by cars? You know, is that what we want? Or do we want to find a way of moving around that's easy, that's equitable, that keeps us fit, you know, that's enjoyable. That's what he's saying, and I think it's a really good way of thinking. It's a little bit like Kunle Adeyemi's response to Makoko, the housing net. He's trying to think a bit differently and creative. What do we really actually need? What do we really want? What are our needs? What are our desires? The next person I want to talk to is this guy, Alejandro Aravena. He's an architect from Chile, and he looked at housing. He's very, very interested in housing, and he saw in South America the need for solutions and resolution of the housing problem. You know, the favelas in Brazil and all over South America are notorious. And again, his attitude was, well, there isn't one big solution. So how can I start working with this problem? So what he did was, he went to a contractor, a big Chilean contractor who was specializing in doing housing. And he said to them, you guys do, you know, $5 trillion worth of work every year, and you're doing the same thing all the time. Let me come and work with you, and I will come up with interesting ideas, not crazy ideas, workable ideas, that might make you more competitive in certain projects that you work with. They said, no problem, that's fine, we'll take you on. They were big enough to pay him a salary. So he joined forces with them, and he started doing some very interesting projects. And one of the projects that he did, and this type of housing is an example of what is called participatory design. And that has a wide range of meanings that I'm not going to go into in this lecture, but he created very, very simple housing blocks like this. It doesn't look particularly beautiful, but it's an identifiable form. But what he did was he saved money by only building half of the lot. And the idea was that when the tenants moved in, when they had enough money, they could add to it. So the cost for somebody to inhabit one unit was reduced so you could build more houses, and then you gave people space to do what they wanted to. So if I repaired shoes, I could continue with my little place where I'm selling shoes and then move into my little social housing. And then maybe I could extend it a little bit and open a little workshop if I was a dressmaker, or if I had a little home business repairing bicycles. I had the space then to do it. Or if my mum wanted to come and live with me because she's too old, or if I wanted to create a little room for my cousin from the country, I had the space to expand. So it gave people scope to expand their existence in a way that they wanted to do. And then in a way, in however impoverished and substandard the way they were living before might have been, they had that freedom and ability to do that. They were just in the wrong place to do it, and the amenities weren't there. And of course, with this, they're now in a place where there are amenities. There's electricity, there's running water, so suddenly the whole standard and quality of life has improved, and people then have the space to do what they want. And it's not so much about what it looks like. One can like it or not like it, but it's about the freedom and the opportunity of the space to live and to inhabit effectively, to lead a full life. And this is an example of a project that we did in Chile that talks a little bit about this principle of participatory housing.
With the Lower Nechea project, the main priority was location. Behind me, you see the group of families in the situation before, meaning they live in a slum. What we're trying to do is that, knowing that the location is so important because schools, transportation, jobs are in this part of the city, which is actually the richest part of the city, what we're looking for was to be able to find a design able to pay for very expensive land but keep all those networks. So much more important than an extra square meter of house was a better located square meter of land, which tends to be expensive. With a subsidy that is about $10,000 that is given to a poor family, then will become an owner of the house. We had to buy the land, provide the infrastructure, and build the house. Instead of producing tiny units, we ask ourselves, why don't we think it's half of a good house? And we thought it was efficient to make the half that a family will never be able to achieve on its own. And then allow families to do their other half on their own, with their own timing, according to their own needs. We call it participatory design. To have a participatory design means to have families sitting on the table to help us decide what are we going to deliver from day one, and what can be then left so that families themselves take care of that.
Nosotros estuvimos desde el principio viendo el proyecto, escogimos nuestro lo que queríamos en las casas. Yo en este momento no le he hecho nada. La casa está exactamente como me la entregaron. Pretendo ponerle piso abajo, poner cerámica. Acá está el baño. No le hemos hecho muchos cambios.
We ask families what is more important, a water heater or a bathtub. There was not enough money for both. Decision makers or politicians or professionals, they normally tend to answer the water heater. And in 100% of the cases, when we ask this to families, they prefer the bathtub over the water heater. You have to understand that they're coming from no water, no sewage. A shower meant to have a can with water in the courtyard, so they're going to have privacy. More important than that, when they move in, they do not have money to pay the gas bill to heat the water. So knowing that in their priorities, bathtub is much higher than water heater, let's do the bathtub and allow them over time to buy the water heater.
De
ninguno, de una película. Think about the final stage and how design can facilitate a family's life to achieve that middle income standard in the future. That's how quality should be measured. And that was definitely not the way social housing was being measured, not the way it was being designed.
So that's Alejandro Aravena, again, another strategy, another way of working. We had Kunle Adeyemi in Lagos with his floating school. And you know, then we have a strategy like Enrique Penaloza's in terms of how people move around the city, how they inhabit the city through moving through it. And then here, a much more prosaic and pragmatic response to housing. If you've got limited money for housing, rather than just producing thousands and thousands and thousands of units that don't work very well, create the units in a way that people can inhabit in an effective way, give them dignity, give them the opportunity to modify their own environment. So it's ways in which architecture and design, yes, there's an aesthetic side to it, but I think when it comes down to human need, in a way, those preoccupations need to play second fiddle to some of the more functional ideas. And yet there is a beauty in those ideas. There is a dignity in them. You know, there is a nice idea if you think about it. Wouldn't it be great if we all left here, we all got on bicycles and went off to work when we were there? I would like that. You know, that would be good fun. Yeah. And wouldn't it be good if people that were living in underprivileged areas could access schools, you know, easily and readily? And in this case, wouldn't it be good if people living in really quite squalid conditions are given an opportunity to live in somewhere that's clean, that's dry, and that's well serviced? So they're all really very effective responses. I'm just going to close off now by just showing you some images of some work that I've been involved with. I shared these with Priya last year. It was some work that we started doing with the HDC. Unfortunately, because of budgetary constraints, they've stopped the project, they say temporarily. But we were asked to look at a number of different areas where the HDC owned property. This is the Beetham. Many of you are familiar with the Beetham. You know, again, a highly stigmatized area, an area that in people's mind is associated, has a negative, stigmatized image. But it's where people live. You know, it's a community. It's where people in this society live. It's locked in between the priority bus routes and the highway with the dump over on the other side of the highway. It's not a particularly wonderful environment. But something needs to be done about it, and needed to be done about it. So we were asked to look at it. You're going to hear a funny noise with this because it's the sound of a drone, but you get an idea of the landscape we're talking about here. living in one part of it reasonable level of accommodation, but in another part there were many, many families. There were sometimes 30 or 40 people living in spaces that had really been designed for 10 or 15. So all of the services, all the infrastructure were being overwhelmed, and commensurate with people living in pretty much abject poverty without a properly supported environment, it created a lot of problems. It created a lot of very, very serious social problems and other issues. So the idea was to look at the Beetham, to look at sea lots, and also to look at Maloney Gardens, and to come up with strategies as to how those areas could be addressed, how responses could be formulated that could alleviate the negativity, the negative aspects of existence in those places. I'm going to show you first the strategy that we looked at for sea lots, and again this image of Port of Spain, downtown Port of Spain, and the waterfront. And then a close-up of the area that is called sea lots. And it's a mixture of industrial use, and you can see around that canal in the middle, on either side, at the bottom, the informal settlements that are developed there. That area, another name for sea lots, the community there is Katanga, and a lot of the people that live there are often people that came from small islands, some of the small islands, started coming over to trading and decided when Trinidad was having an economic boom to settle there. And that was an available place to settle. It was easy to put up an informal shack there and start living there. But over time, it's become a community. You know, it's an identifiable community. But because of its location downtown, in considering how downtown should or could be developed as part of a number of projects that urban planners had considered, this became a bit of a problem. Because we all know we've got the Hyatt Hotel there, you've got some fancy buildings around Independence Square. There's room and scope for more hotels, more high-end commercial development, and perhaps some room for some industrial or commercial. But what happens to the people that live there? You know, do you just pick them up and say it's in everybody's interest for you to go somewhere else, or do you try and accommodate them? So we started. We were given these areas to focus on to identify what we could do with them, and we tried to kind of look and see what the kind of urban form and the urban structure was there. So we looked at the different types of land use, different types of use that the land surrounding there was put to, how it was employed. So there's commercial use. There's the priority bus route coming into City Gate at the top. And we organized those spaces. This is just high-level kind of strategic planning. Then we tried to formulate zones or areas within the informal housing sector, and you can see them in the center of that. We kind of rationalized those. And we created in those spaces the idea of kind of framework structures that people could inhabit